Hope no one was bitten by snakes this long weekend, especially in the southern part of the country where poisonous snakes make it their home. Snake bites in Papua New Guinea are almost always lethal. They kill more people than malaria or tuberculosis within a given environment. But there is little in terms of awareness. We hear again from snake expert Dr. David Williams, who's been trying to develop an anti-venom in Papua New Guinea. Thank you, Doctor, for coming on to PNG tonight.
It's great to be here, John.
Okay, we're going to talk about snakes, poisonous snakes in Papua New Guinea, how deadly they are, and what little or whatever information we have, we know about them or we don't. You are into this. You're into snake venom, anti-venom. Tell us about snakes, its danger, and the work you're doing.
Okay, well, the thing is, people have got a perception in Papua New Guinea that every snake is dangerous, and the reality couldn't be further from the truth. So you've got over 120 different kinds of snakes that are found either on land or in water.
Okay.
And of those, the land snakes, let's start with them, only seven of them are capable of killing human beings.
Some are edible.
Some are. Some are very edible.
Yeah.
When you look at the sea snakes, there's probably 20 or 30 species of sea snakes living in the oceans around Papua New Guinea. But again, very few people ever get bitten by them, and there are maybe four or five species that would be considered medically dangerous.
Okay.
So there's actually not a lot of dangerous snakes. The problem is the few that we've got
are lethal,
and they're really good at biting people.
Okay. What are they? Death adders, Papuan blacks?
Well, the common perception, of course, when people come to hospital with a snake bite, you say, what did you get bitten by? It's always Papuan black.
Okay.
But the truth of the matter is, poor old Papuan black snake is innocent. He gets the blame for somebody else's misdeeds.
Okay.
And the real culprit is what we call a Papuan taipan, which, if you want to put it on a linear scale, is probably 1,000 times more dangerous.
Wow.
It has longer fangs. It produces more venom. The venom is hundreds of times more potent. And whereas the black snake prefers to quietly disappear when it encounters a human being and not have to bite somebody in the first place, a taipan, if it feels that you're too close to it, will come across the road, bite you on the foot, and then disappear.
Okay. And you're dead.
So you're dealing with a very dangerous snake. In fact, we've tested the venom of taipans from this country, and it's considerably more potent than any other land snake that's been tested. So in other words, it's probably the most dangerous snake in the world.
Wow.
In terms of the drop-for-drop potency of its venom.
Wow.
So it needs less than 0.009 of a milligram per kilogram to kill you.
To kill you. Wow.
So in other words...
So a little drop from its fang, how many is that? How many people can it kill?
Well, literally, they produce enough venom, they could kill thousands of people with what they produce in a single bite.
Okay.
And the amount that would be needed to kill the average person is not even enough to wet the head of a match.
So what are we doing about it? I mean, you're doing some work on it, you're doing some training, you're doing some research. Where is it? Where are those snakes? And what's the work being done here?
Well, taipans are limited to the southern half of the country in the coastal savanna woodlands and grasslands. Elsewhere in the country, you do get things like death adders and small-eyed snakes and brown snakes and so on. But the taipan is really common here in Central Province,
right. In
Port Moresby. We see 100 cases of snake bite every year from within the NCD. So people who are walking in patches of grass near footpaths, who go off into little areas of bushland to raise a garden, kids who go hunting birds in bits of grassland, that sort of thing. So that's 100 people a year just from Port Moresby alone. And then
that's the ones that you know.
That's the ones that we know. And then within Central Province, our snake bite clinic at the Port Moresby General Hospital treats about 300 cases that come from the province itself. So all up about 400 cases a year just here. And to put that in perspective, in Australia, Every hospital in Australia, if you tallied up the number of snake bites they treat in a year, would be about the same number. So we're treating the same number of snake bites in one hospital as all of the hospitals in Australia.
Yes, and Australia has so many dangerous snakes and...
Well, exactly. It's got the reputation for having the most dangerous snakes, but the reality is we outclass them well and truly in that sense.
Wow.
But, you know, the problem is that snakes live in places that people like to use. So in your gardens where you're growing your fruit and vegetables, they like the grasslands that you make your bush paths to get to your garden or to get to the creek to get water or whatever it might be. They're very good at living close to people's homes.
Yeah.
So taipans in particular here in Port Moresby often get caught in people's backyards.
Okay. They're living after under, what, scraps and rodents and
they live rats. Under a few sheets of tin or in a wood pile or, you know, any sort of rubbish that's lying around or in drains, they can hide in there and they come to eat the rats and mice.
Okay.
You know, and we leave lots of rubbish around, so rats and mice are quite common. And the snakes come for that. And, of course, the unintended consequence is that if you encounter one of these snakes, you're very likely to get bitten.
Wow. You're developing antivenom.
We are, yes. Papua New Guinea has used Australian antivenoms very successfully for over 50 years.
Okay.
And their antivenoms are very good. But the problem is they're also very expensive.
Yes.
And Papua New Guinea simply can't afford to buy all of the antivenom it needs at those prices. So about 10 years ago, we thought about the idea of, well, why can't we make our own and solve the problem that way? And in so doing, not only would we solve the problem of not having enough antivenom to treat all the snake bites, but we could provide employment for local scientists and doctors. We could produce a fledgling industry that could see Papua New Guinea one day making its own drugs and medicines and not having to import them. As well as developing the capacity in all of these areas so that we would become a smarter country. And everyone said, you can't do it. You know, we talked to different manufacturers and said, you know, would they be willing to help us? And if some of them said, well, look, you're wasting your time. It's going to cost you $15 or $20 million. It's just technologically too difficult. Don't worry about it. But we were lucky in that we found a partner in Costa Rica, of all places, the University of Costa Rica in San Jose, who turned around and said, well, if you can supply the snake venom, we'll make the anti-venom and we'll do it for nothing.
Okay. And do it over there in Costa Rica?
So they made it for us. Yeah.
Okay.
And our concept is that they're making the anti-venom for us. We're now testing it here at Port Moresby General Hospital in clinical trials. So it's actually being administered to patients and we're getting excellent results.
Okay.
Now, at the end of that trial, which is going to be about a month from now, we'll look at all of the data and we'll assemble it and then we'll make a submission to the National Department of Health to have that product registered for general use, which means it'll be able to go out to health centres and aid posts and other hospitals for use. And our aim is that we will then work towards localising the production. So we need to train scientists to be able to make it. They need to go to Costa Rica for training or go to Australia for training. We need to build the facilities. We need the physical infrastructure, the laboratory. We need to have horses that we can immunise with the snake venom because we're actually using antibodies made in horses to make a snake antivenom. And our plan would be that within the next 10 years, we would be making the product 100% here locally with local staff running it, everything completely localised. And that way Papua New Guinea can stand on its own two feet to meet its own need in this particular area.
Yeah.
But the real benefit is a lot of the technology that we're using to make antivenoms is also used to make other medicines, and in particular vaccines. So potentially what we could do is we could provide Papua New Guinea with the capacity to have its own pharmaceutical industry where it meets its own needs for particular things like vaccines and antivenom and maybe some other drugs. So that's the sort of long-term road that we're on.
Yes. Most people in Papua New Guinea don't know that snake bites and its consequences is in fact a disease in this country, but we don't treat it like that.
No, people don't think of snake bite as a disease, and that is a problem in terms of getting the issue recognised, not just here, but all around the world. Okay. But the reality is the snake bite itself is a physical injury. The snake punctures your skin and it then injects toxins into your body. Now, those toxins affect all sorts of organs. They can affect the heart, the brain, the lungs, the liver, the kidneys. They can affect your blood. They can affect your actual muscle tissue and your skin tissue itself, causing pathology that's exactly the same as we see in many other types of disease, but for which still the best treatment is to deal with the toxin causing it.
Yes.
If we neutralise the toxin, then the body tends to heal itself. So it's very important that they understand that snake bite is a disease and it is something that we can actually treat.
It's all just shrouded in mystery that when you get bitten by a snake, the spirits are responsible, the ghosts are responsible.
Yeah, exactly. So that and I can understand that because in my culture, in the Anglo-Saxon culture, 1,000 years ago, we had exactly the same mindset because that was the only way we could explain things. But, you know, with the development of modern medicine and education, we now have a better understanding of what snake bite is, that it is actually caused by chemicals that the snake injects into the body, and that there are medical ways in which we can treat that.
Your work's extraordinary. Are you getting some attention from authorities here, the government, health department?
Well, we try to work as closely as we can with government. We've worked in particular with the Science and Research Technology Secretariat, which is through the Higher Education Department, and the Office of Higher Education, because we're based at the University of Papua New Guinea, and what we do is about education as well as about research. We try to work as closely as we can with the health department as well, but we're always in favour of strengthening our links.
Funding, you're getting anything?
Most of the work we've done has been funded from Australia up until now. So we were very fortunate. Again, it's a case of we were told this was impossible, that the Australian government wouldn't give us a grant to do work in another country. And I don't know, I don't take no very easily. No. So we put an application in and lo and behold, they gave us $1.4 million to fund our current clinical trials.
That runs out though in June.
Well, it does. So June this year, we've got to find funding from other sources. So at the moment, we're talking to different organisations to see about the continuity of funding from July onwards.
Yeah, good luck to that. I think the work you're doing is quite important. You're also going, we are running out of time, you're going overseas, you're going to Geneva, you're going to talk about venom and snakes, and PNG is going to be mentioned over there. Just tell us a little bit.
Well, it is. I mean, I guess the other hat that I wear, I'm also the CEO of the Global Snake Bite Initiative because snake bite's a problem all around the world, particularly in the tropics. And at the moment, there's a crisis with anti-venom supply in Africa, which WHO is trying to deal with. So I'm one of the experts that have been asked to go to Geneva to sit on a committee that's going to look at evaluating the current anti-venoms that they have over there.
Okay.
but in the wider sense, we've also been working here through the Minister for Health and HIV AIDS, Michael Malabag, as one of the member states of WHO, Papua New Guinea have asked WHO to have a meeting in May to address the issue of snake bite. We have about 20 countries that have agreed to attend this meeting, and we're hoping that what it will lead to will be a resolution by the World Health Organization to actually seriously invest in fixing snake bite problems all around the world, not just here, but everywhere where it's a concern.
You say evaluate. I take it that there are some work that are not authentic.
Well, this is the problem, In places like Africa, unfortunately, it's like with many drugs, there's a lot of drugs on the market that haven't been properly tested, properly evaluated for both their safety and their effectiveness. So it's one thing to have a drug that will cure the disease, but if that drug makes you sick in the process, that's a big problem. Okay. So a lot of the anti-venoms in sub-Saharan Africa haven't actually been properly tested. So WHO's come up with a process for trying to sift through the available evidence and come up with a list of products that it thinks it can recommend. And that's the process that we're going to be involved in.
Okay, doctor. We're running out of time. Just quickly, if I was bitten by a snake, what should I do? What can you tell the people that who might be bitten by snakes?
All right, well, the first thing you should do is don't try to catch it and kill it. Mm-hmm. Don't use a tourniquet. Don't use a razor blade or a bit of broken glass to cut your skin because snake venom will make you bleed and your blood will run like water. stay still. You can bandage the limb the same way that you would bandage a sprained ankle to put pressure on it to slow the movement of the venom. But really, the best thing that can be done is come to the hospital as quickly as possible. Go to the first health centre you can get to, or if you're able to, come straight to Port Moresby General Hospital and we'll take good care of you.
Dr. David Williams, thanks for talking to us.
It's a pleasure.
Dr. David Williams, this has been PNG Tonight. Thank you for watching. We'll have for you another program at the same time tomorrow night. Good night.